Thanks, JD. We appreciate you using your gifts to help us connect with the Lord and by finishing on my all-time favorite hymn. So thanks. He didn't tell me he was going to do that, but that's just the bonus. You know what I mean? Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou, God, you're my inheritance now and always. Amen, huh? I had that on a post-it note on the front of my truck for, oh man, months just reflecting on that. So, well, hey, here's our last time together in this type of setting. So, again, thanks for having me up, Tim, and it's been fun to be with you guys. I have a special place in my heart for Montana. I even bought boots between last year and this year because I got so inspired. You know what I mean? That was good stuff. I remember Jason picking me up at the airport last year. He said, Drew, what do you look like? I said, well, I got a red beard, I'm bald, and I'm overweight. He says, you're going to fit right in Montana, man. I said, all right, that'll work. But Rich, thanks so much for sharing. What you shared from the heart, it hits each and every one of us. And Glenn Hogan and Phil Ward are great friends of mine, and they've had incredible impact in my life. And I know that you've had a lot of impact in other men's lives all around Montana, Billings, and wherever else you are. So thanks for your service and your hard labor. And I think today we're going to look at what does it look like when the Lord would say to us, good job, well done, good and faithful servant. And Rich, I pray that you would hear that from the Lord this morning. So thanks for sharing with us. You know, just to recap, you know, Friday night we talked about what does it look like to be a laborer? What's the definition of a laborer? And what qualifies us to be a laborer? It's the gospel. It's the fact that Jesus has brought us into his family that qualifies us to be a laborer. Yesterday we looked at what does it look like to be a marked man? How do we become a laborer for Christ? And I think that's the idea of being with him, both in relationship and in mission. And when those two things are coming together, then we become a marked man in our culture, in our churches, in our families, in our communities, that we live for something different. This morning I want to talk about our vision of the Navigators, that we would see lifetime laborers raised up. Whether you go to Dallas Theological Seminary, or whether you, sell feed or seed or whatever else you do, you're an insurance salesman, you're a businessman, you're a teacher, you're an engineer, you're a rancher, we want you guys to be a lifelong laborer. And we're going to look at this morning, just the title of this message is that laborers labor. Workers work and laborers labor. Let me pray. We've already prayed, but let me commit this time again to the Lord and we'll open the word together. Father, thanks so much for this morning. We are grateful for who you are, for how much you love us, for all that you've done for us. Lord, we honor you, the great King, the one and only Holy God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, we say. Lord, this morning, our friends and family are most likely attending our local churches, but this morning I pray we'd have church right here. That we'd worship you, we'd connect with you, we'd hear from you. Would we leave, Lord, knowing that we're qualified by you, that our competency comes from Christ, that we would be marked men in our culture who live and walk deeply with you and live wildly for you. And today I pray that you would move in us, Lord. Help us count the cost. Help us understand the rewards. Help us understand the family business of what it looks like to be a lifetime laborer in making our lives count for you. Jesus, I pray that you'd move, you'd help us stay attentive, maybe with less sleep than we normally get in a weekend. Would you help us focus in on you during this time now? In your name we pray, amen. Paul said in Philippians 2:9, if you want to flip over there with me, it's a fascinating little read. Paul has these insights into the future that I just love to read about, and I like to try and figure out what the heck is he talking about. But in Philippians 2, we have the great passage on, that we should be imitators of Christ, that Christ was the very nature of God, yet didn't grasp equality with God. In Philippians 2, verses 9 through 10, it's in this section. Paul's speaking, and he says this in Philippians 2, 9 and 10. Therefore, God exalted him, Jesus, to the highest place, and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Paul's talking about the deity of Christ. And you know, God, Jesus was the great God-man, both God, fully God, and both man, fully man, and yet in the same person. And here Paul talks about that one day God will esteem Jesus in the highest place that is above every place, to give him a name that is above every name. And then check this out, ready? Verse 10, that the name of Jesus, when Jesus' name is proclaimed, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Can you imagine this reality? This is going to happen. One day, every angel, every person already with God, to be out of the bodies, to be present with the Lord, everyone in heaven will proclaim, Jesus is Lord. One day, every person on the earth will proclaim, Jesus is Lord. One day, everyone under the earth will proclaim, Jesus is Lord. Every knee will bow, declaring that Jesus is the King over all. I think about the two different ways this will be received for the glory of God as Jesus is properly placed on his throne to rule for eternity. I, for one, will be rejoicing and bowing before my King. Oh, Jesus, you're Lord. Hallelujah. But I think of my atheist friends. You know what will be happening? They too will bow. They too will profess. Jesus is Lord. Some of us will have great joy. Some of the world will have great horror in understanding that truth. I think there'll be some people so obstinate still that they will not want to bow, and they'll clench their fist and they'll say, no, not me. I think the angels will see to it that they bow. Amen. I don't know if they'll come around and break knees. I don't know if they'll come down. I mean, but it says every knee will bow before the King. He will have the glory due his name. And the coolest part for you and I is we understand that we're qualified to be a laborer, that we can be marked as a laborer, and if we have a lifestyle of a laborer, the greatest privilege that we have, besides knowing and entering into great fellowship with God the Father, is that we have the joy of co-laboring with Jesus to plunder the depths of hell and to bring as many people with us into the presence of the joyous Savior as we can. The reality is, Jesus says, the road is broad. It's like a highway that leads to death and destruction. And the path is very narrow of those who find salvation. And yet we get to be the men who help people move from the broad road of destruction to that narrow road of finding hope in Christ. And I want to submit to you today that one of the things that laborers do is they labor. Sounds kind of silly. But we started out with this verse. We're going to look at it again. Matthew 9, 37 through 38. This idea of the harvest field. When Jesus again was speaking, let's just reset our minds on this. Matthew chapter 9, verses 37 through 38. Jesus said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Now, what did he want us to do once we get in the harvest field? Anybody? To start working. Send workers out into the harvest field to work. This is our design. Our design is to work in the harvest field. Our design, I was talking with Corey this morning. Corey, where are you at? I know you're in here somewhere. Here's Corey. Corey talking about a neighbor who he's trying to reach and how it's going to be difficult and how there'll be unique challenges to that situation. But Corey's ready to work. Lord, what would you do? How would you use me? This situation is bigger than me, but I want you to do something here. He's ready to work. It is our design as I begin to meet with the Savior to want to flow this out into the world around him. One of my favorite quotes is from a missionary to Iran in the 1950s who, for obvious reasons, remained anonymous. So they said this, "A ship is safe in the harbor, but that's not what a ship is designed for." A ship is safe in the harbor. That's not what a ship is designed for. You know, it would be silly for a farmer who's working a big field to get on his overalls that day and to gas up the tractor and get it ready to go and pull up his rubber boots and then just to go sit out on a lounge chair with a glass of iced tea for the rest of the day and think anything's going to get done. Laborers labor. Workers work. And we are entering into the family business with the Almighty. God has called us really at a great privilege to ourselves to engage with what he is doing in the lost and dying world around us. You know, he is busy about his business. Not busyness like we understand it, not running ragged like we tend to do. He is very strategic, but he is busy about his business, and there is a lot to do. Let's flip back over to John 15, where we were last night. There's a couple other things that I want to highlight as we look at what does it look like to labor in the kingdom of God. John 15, verses 14 through 15. We've talked about this a few times, but I think it's worth bearing in mind this morning. John 14, you are my friends if you do what I command. Verse 15, I no longer call you servants because a servant doesn't know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends, for everything I learned from my Father I have made known to you. Jesus has called us friends. He has entered us into his family. We are adopted as sons into the High King's family. And for what reason? We talked about last night, to bear fruit, fruit that lasts, to bear much fruit. Verse 8, Rich said, mentioned both of these verses this morning, that this is to my Father's glory, that we bear much fruit, that workers would work and bear fruit. It's a fair question to look in our lives and say, am I bearing fruit in the kingdom? And if I'm not, am I walking closely with the Lord? Because I know that if I'm walking with him, then I will bear fruit. And it's that lasting fruit. And then look at verse 16. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. Then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command. Love each other. You'll be known, you'll be proven to be my disciples when we bear fruit, and fruit that lasts. Have you ever thought about, for a minute, what's important 300 million years from now? To you. Turn to the person next to you and talk about what is important to you 300 million years from now, okay? What would be important to you? Ready, set, go. All right, let me hear it. Is anything possibly important 300 million years from now? Wes, what do you think? Yeah. That's great. That's great. Other thoughts, Brandon? Eternity with God, that'll still matter, won't it? Yeah, 300 million years from now, we will still be with God. I like the first day. What a wild thing. No need for a watch anymore. Outside of space and time as we know it. That's fascinating. What else? I had a buddy who thought, man, if it's for millions of years, we're going to listen to harp music. I don't know if I want to go. I was like, bro, it's going to be way better than that. Relax, relax. It's going to be way better. I had a good friend just pass away, Dr. J, an elder in our church. He was in his late 70s and had a couple of medical complications. He just passed away about a week and a half ago. And he was pretty much out of it, unconscious. His family was there. And he woke up for a brief minute, and he stood and looked at his whole family. He said, this is more amazing than you could ever imagine. I can't believe what I'm seeing. And he died. How cool to be at the bedside of a saint. He just came up, just boom. They shared it, and they were like, what? And then he's gone. And that's how he would want to go out if you knew Dr. J. He would have been like, whoa, come on, everybody. I mean, just, and he's there worshiping now after being unconscious for hours, erupts to say that, and then goes home to be with his Savior. What else is important 300 million years from now? Adam, what's important 300 million years from now? Amen. Yeah. And it keeps multiplying. Keeps going. The generation, that ripple effect continues. Yeah. I don't know that the I don't know that the earth as we know it will be around in 300 million years. I'd like to think the Lord comes back relatively soon. What else? Anybody else? What's important 300 million years from now? Yeah. Amen. Yeah. There'll be no more sin. I can't wait for that. Are you kidding me? No more locks on the door. No more need for a police force. No more need to watch. I mean, it's fascinating what won't be needed. No more doctors. No more sin. No more disease. No more pain. Bring it on. Are you kidding me? You know, 300 million years from now, what's going to still matter is kind of who you loved, who loved you, and who's with you in heaven. And God's word won't pass away. God will never pass away. But I often ask students, because students are invincible. You know, 18 to 22, they can do no wrong. They do crazy stuff. I'm like, you're going to die one day doing this. Now, we're all going to die, right? Dr. J, the man I just told you about who was just went home to be with the Lord, one of his favorite sayings was, hey, everybody's going to croak. What happens to you after that? And that was one of his big sayings, was everybody's going to croak. And he would remind us that the mortality rate in America is still 100%. It's going to happen. Brandon, you're the youngest guy in the room. One day, you will go home to be with the Father. And I want you to bring as many people with you as you can. But you can imagine, on Monday morning, typically, after a weekend, what's the number one question you get on a Monday morning? Anybody? How was your weekend? Hey, how was your weekend? What'd you do? How was it? You have a good time? Man, I feel like sometimes I got to perform on the weekend just so I have something to say. You ever get that way? You kind of feel like, oh man, actually I took a nap on Saturday and didn't do anything I was supposed to on Sunday. It was a pretty good weekend. But students, man, they're just dying to tell you what they did. I went snowboarding and then I did this and then I jumped off a rock and then, I mean, just whatever it is. But every Monday morning, people ask that same question. How was your weekend? How was your weekend? How was your weekend? One day, I'm going to see Nolan in heaven, or Tim, or Wes, or, goodness gracious, I'm blanking on other people's names. Othniel. Guess what we're going to ask each other? How was your lifetime? How was your time on earth? What'd you do for the king? What'd you get done? Did you labor? Did you have a good life? Or did you squander it? Now, I don't know if we're going to say that. I don't know if we can bring up all the sinful stuff once we're there. He says he removes it as far as the east is from the west. If you think about that, that's an immeasurable distance. If I go east from here, I just keep going east around the world. It's an immeasurable point. If I go west, I'm always going west. I love that the Bible can't be fooled. In those days, they thought the world was flat. If you went north, you'd eventually come back around south. Then you'd go north. Then you'd go south. But east and west works, amen? And he's removed our sins that far from us. Can you imagine getting up there? Don't you want something to say? Hey, how was your lifetime? No, man, I tell you what. Now, all of us would say we could have done more. All of that's just the reality of living in a fallen world. But to get there and say, you know what? I swung for the fence. I had won it back. And I wanted to either strike out or crank that ball. And so I swung as hard as I could for the kingdom. I tried to live in such a way that if God didn't exist, my life made no sense. Now that we're here, it makes perfect sense, and I wish I'd have done more. As men, what we don't want to do is get into heaven thinking, I wish I would have, I wish I could have, I should have, these types of things. I want to live the life that I know God's asking me to live right now. Because see, there's a call for evangelism all over the place in the scriptures. There's a call to make disciples all over the place. If we think about it from above, we think of the Lord Jesus. We've talked about the Great Commission several times this weekend, but the idea that all authority on heaven and earth has been given to Jesus. He says, therefore, go make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I'm with you to the very end of the age. In Mark chapter 16, the same account of the Great Commission, Mark records it and says that Jesus says, and this gospel will be preached to the ends of the earth, and then, anybody know what it says? The end will come. Game on. This gospel will be preached to every creature on earth, and then the end will come. There is a goal in this. My 8-year-old Dax, he turns 8 in a couple of months. He plays soccer, and boy, there is a big goal to what we're doing. And I love Dax. His first soccer game, he gets out there and he scores a goal and everybody's cheering for him and they're little guys and running around like, you know, just a little mob around the ball. Yeah, exactly. I mean, boy, if you could get one kid to not look at the airplane that flies above, you'll win every soccer game. You know what I mean? In that same game, he realized he likes the applause of everybody. So he got the ball the next time, and he runs down to the goals and knocks it in. And everybody cheers, but not as loud. His buddies are still high-fiving him, but he knocked it in the wrong goal. No goalies at that age. It's pretty fun. He knocked another goal in that same game. Wrong goal. Finally, his coach had to say, "Dax, good job. Way to go. We got to get it in the blue goal. You got to go all through all those guys." He's like, "Well, it's a lot easier when no one's running after me, coach." But there's a goal to what we're doing, and it's reaching the ends of the earth for him. It's reaching the world for Christ. And Jesus has said, boy, we want you to be making disciples of all the nations. But have you ever stopped and thought about this? Flip with me in your Bibles over to Luke 16. It's probably a familiar passage for many of us. It's debated whether or not it is a parable or an actual story, Luke 16. And in Luke 16, we have the story of the rich man and Lazarus. Do you guys remember this story? And what's going on here is that there's a man, I'll just read the first, just to give us some of the context. There's a rich man who was, I'm in Luke 16, 19. Luke 16, verse 19. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. I would say he probably lived in America. At his gate was a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. Not exactly living the same life of luxury. The time came when the beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. And the rich man also died and was buried in hell, where he was in torment. He looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. Verse 24. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me." Remember, this is the rich man who's now in hell, is what the Bible's saying. "Have pity on me." I lost my spot. Yep. So he called him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I'm in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things, while Lazarus received bad things, but now he's comforted here, and you're in agony. Besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over there to us." Now listen to what this rich man Lazarus, who's in what the Bible would describe as hell at this point, okay? Listen to what he asks Abraham to do. Verse 27, he answered, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them so that they will also, they will not also come to this place of torment." And Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead goes to them, they'll repent." He said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophet, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." Now, Jesus has given us a command to reach all the world. And what is this guy? Now, I believe this is a real story. I don't believe this is a parable. In no other parable do people named, and there's a few other things that we could get into. That's not this sermon. This guy, Lazarus, is up there with Abraham. The rich man is saying, "Let Lazarus just dip his finger to, just give me a drop of water to cool me in this agony." "Well, we can't do that. There's a chasm fixed, and we can't cross over from here to there." And what does the rich man beg Lazarus to do? Anybody? What's that? "Would you send someone to do evangelism to my family?" Think about that for a second. He's not in this position of, "I don't believe this, da da da." "Hey, Abraham, would you please send somebody to my family and tell them not to come here? Would you send someone to go spread the message of salvation? Would you send somebody to go save my family?" There is a call from hell for evangelism. There's a call from above, sure. But even those who are in the place of torment now are calling that others would be reached for Christ, that they would not have the same fate. I had a friend who was a missionary, still is, in Tokyo, Japan. Less than 1% believers in the nation of Japan. They labor intensely and see very little fruit. And this guy was getting very close to accepting Jesus as his Savior, and he's with my buddy Mark, and Mark was there with him, and they were talking, and the guy, he gets the gospel, he understands it, he wants it, and he says, "Mark, if I believe this, then what I have to also accept is all of my ancestors before me are in hell. I would be the first man in my entire family for as many generations as I know that would accept this. And you're to tell me that my entire family that's gone before me is in hell if I accept this as truth." And Mark said, "Yeah, let me show you a passage." And they went right here. And he said, "I bet if your family could come out of the grave, they would plead with you to make this decision and make a change for the rest of the generations of family to come after you." And that man bowed his head and received Christ as his Lord. And the reality is, here we have a call from above. We have a call from below. And even Paul hammers on this. I'll flip over there real quick. You don't need to go with me. But it's in Philippians chapter 1. Paul is preaching here. And he says in verses 15 to 18, he says this. This is pretty awesome. He says this: "It is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry." These are people who are trying to preach this. Paul doesn't know what he's doing. "I know what I'm doing. But others out of goodwill, they're preaching Christ." Ready? "The latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition." But listen to this: "Not sincerely, supposing they can stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice." Paul says, "I don't care if a guy's motives are good or bad. If he's out there preaching, I can get on board with that. Because Christ's word is getting out." But I want to share with you, as we talk about being a laborer, I'd be remiss if I didn't show you a quick illustration of what I like to show people. What do the navigators do? What are we trying to do in raising up laborers, okay? Let's, Jen, I'm going to go to those pictures now. Is that cool? This is kind of what I would kind of call our current reality, or kind of how we're doing things in society today. Let's say that this is a large group meeting like this, or maybe like your local church, okay? Go ahead, Jen. And this is your preacher in the middle. Don't get wowed by my graphics. I was an industrial designer. Please don't get distracted by the graphics. But this is your preacher, okay? Or maybe someone who's doing what I'm doing, opening up the word, okay? And if my only method, let's say you go to that church. Go ahead, Jen. And if my only method is I go and I want to hear what the guy up front says. This is how we do church in America today. Go ahead, Jen. Let's go another one. And then if you have enough people coming to listen to what the guy up front says, then most people in the community go, "Wow, God is up to something." And can I just say, oftentimes, he might be. But we also know that bigger is not always necessarily better. And that in the kingdom, numbers don't always equate to what is God doing. We have a church in my town that has almost 40,000 people attending their Easter service. Are you kidding me? It's one of the biggest churches west of the Mississippi. And the men and women who run that place are godly, God-fearing evangelicals. They are preaching the word, and I'm really proud of what they're doing. And they are casting big, broad nets and catching every low piece of hanging fruit within a three-state area. We got people coming from Wyoming and Kansas and other places just to this church. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. There's got to be one good church between Kansas and here. But their hope is, okay, and then what they're really leaning into is that, let's say I want to bring a friend, or a friend of mine has questions about spirituality, maybe a coworker or a neighbor, maybe it's Corey's neighbor, and he starts to ask questions. And what if my only method is like what we can do next, Jen, is I'm going to bring my buddy, okay? This is now you. And you come in and you want to hear. Let's go one more. And now I want to bring my buddy, and I'm hoping that my neighbor, Jeff, or somebody, I'll bring him in, okay? And I'm hoping, go ahead one more, that whatever the preacher says hits him somehow. You guys see the little words going out there? Now, I got to hope that whatever the preacher planned that day is going to hit my coworker or my neighbor or my friend or my family member in such a way that maybe if we go out for a burger afterwards, he wants to talk about it. Now, what if this is my only method? What are some of the downsides of that? Turn to the person next to you, and if this is my only method for reaching the world for Christ, that I bring my buddy to the big Christian thing so that he might hear from my pastor or Bible teacher or whatever, what are some of the drawbacks if that's the only tool in my toolbox? Turn to the person next to you, and the guy with the lighter color shirt goes first. Ready, set, go. Downsides. This is the only tool in your tool bag. And here, can I just say, can you make sure you hear this? This is not unbiblical. Jesus taught in the synagogues. Jesus taught the masses. In our churches today, we really elevate the preaching of the word. We're doing this right now. This is not unbiblical in any way, shape, or form, okay? So this is a method, okay, of how we can make disciples and how we can preach the word. But what are some of the drawbacks? Anybody? It's backwards. The people should be going out and share. Okay, great. What else? Yeah.
Your neighbor may not feel comfortable going to church.
Yeah, my buddies don't want to come with me. I mean, I think of like Easter or Christmas, like the easy ones. I'm like, Jonathan, you want to come with me to church? Good buddy of mine, Mr. Colorado. Nah, dude. Come on, man, it's Easter. Nah. All right. Well, you want to catch a beer after dinner, after work one time, and maybe talk about some of these spiritual things and look at Jesus' life? Yeah, let's do that. Okay, game on. I didn't have a beer till I was 29, but guys, I finally figured out they wanted to go out for a beer after work. So I thought, well, okay, then we'll do this then. You know what I mean? I still hate this stuff. What else? What else is a drawback? I'd rather have a Mountain Dew any day of the week. What else? What else is a drawback? Totally. You ever brought a friend to a message and you're like, oh no, we're talking about the seven-headed dragon from Revelations today? You know what I mean? We're talking about speaking in tongues? What is it? He's going to go bananas. Great. Yeah, what else? What else? Anything else? There's no compounded interest. What do you mean by that?
Well, you're relying on him to receive the message. And if he doesn't,
it's the end of the road.
You're meeting one-on-one and then he meets one-on-one and he meets one-on-one.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great. That's good. The compound in there is great. Good stuff. Yeah, you know, I have a lot of friends that are pastors. I meet with a lot of pastors in Denver. And I tell you what, can I just tell you, being a senior pastor, pray for your pastors. Pray for those who teach the word. Because, man, you might have everybody from a 13-year-old who's ready to go, from a 25-year-old who doesn't know Christ, to another guy who's, man, he's ready to go to the mission field, just say the word, and another guy whose business is collapsing, or this guy's marriage is on the rocks, and you got a guy who's 90 years old, and you got a guy who's 9 years old, and can you imagine trying to teach to that every week? That's why I think the word of God is transcendent. Jen, let's go one more picture. Can you know, to say something that actually hits all these different people is a real challenge. And I want to encourage you, pray for your pastors. Pray that they preach the word of God, that it would illuminate in people's hearts. But Jen, let's go to another one. Let's talk about what we're trying to do here a little bit with the Navigators, okay? What if you had a group of fellas? You know, what if it's Tim and Jason and Othniel meeting at a coffee shop? And what if they're talking about life? And what if they're getting in the word together and they're sharing what they're learning about God, what they're learning about life, what they're learning about ministry. They're memorizing verses. They're learning how to reach out to other people. It's one man pouring into another with the expectation that they will have a man. Where's your man? Dawson Tromedy, grab him by the collar. These Navy guys, where's your man? He'd do it to the women. Where's your woman? Who are you pouring into? Who are you trying to reproduce your life into? But you know, all these guys have different spheres of influence. Let's go one more, Jen. You know, they've all got, go ahead. They've got, maybe family, work friends, others. Let's go one more, Jen. You know, if we all started to list out all the different places of influence that we had, you know, Jay's got church friends. He's got his neighborhood. You know, you might have work buddies. You might have the guys you go to the gym with. You might have the guys you go fishing with. You might have the guy down the road. Let's go one more, Jen. And let's say, you know, we've all got these different spheres of influence. You know, I think of our neighborhood. I'm part of a Land Cruiser club in Denver. I like to go off-road driving, and it's this much cooler than a Star Trek convention, okay? But all the guys drive Land Cruisers. I've been in that club for 2 years, 3 years before a guy asks me even what I do, because our common ground is over these old trucks, you know what I mean? So now when somebody, go ahead, Jen, when we have a guy who has a question, and he might be over here in Brandon's sphere of influence, maybe one of his wrestling buddies or something like that. If Brandon's only method is, hey, great question, why don't you come with me to the church next Sunday, and maybe I'm hoping my pastor will say something that kind of hits you where you need it. But what if Brandon's ready because he spent time in the Word, because he saw the Word of God as living, breathing, able to make him effective? You know, that he might be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That he might have a verse memorized by a topic where he can go, you know what, that's a great question. Can I tell you what I've learned about that? Even if he doesn't know, Brandon, what are you, 15? Is that what you told me? You know, even if he doesn't know, to say, that is an awesome question. I'm going to go talk to a few people that I think have the answer. Can we hang out tomorrow and I'll give you my best shot at it? Do you see how that's really different? And now I don't have to get them through another big hurdle, another big step to come and learn more. I get to be the one who can help them right where he is. Can I just tell you, I want my friends who I'm meeting with and answering their questions to come to church with me. My pastor is amazing. The worship through song is amazing in my church. He's going to meet people like Dr. J who are older, who love Jesus, and he's going to get to see different perspective than what he sees day to day. But I'll tell you right now, if I can do this, where a man is equipped to help another man grow, and I'm just out in the labor field, and wherever the fruit's ripe, I'm just picking and pulling and seeing what God's up to. This is a method, I think, that can be wildly, wildly explosive. Can I just tell you, many people are doing the attraction model of, if I can get a good enough preacher up front, he can make me laugh a little bit, cry a little bit, the PowerPoint's good, the music's like a rock concert, then more people will want to come. And I'm not saying we don't do things with excellence or try and do things really well, but the attraction model is bigger is better, and God must really be up to something. Can I tell you that this method that we've got up here is wildly effective? Have you ever thought for a minute, when Jesus was crucified, how big was his ministry? How significant did it look? You know what he had? 11 scared dudes hiding out. I mean, we probably got 40, 50 dudes here. 11 guys, scared to do anything, hiding, going back to fishing, we see in John 21. And the reality is, if you tried to take a measure, how good was Jesus' ministry? Like, take a snapshot. Well, actually, for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I might have expected a little more than 11 ragtag guys who are running scared. Amen? But there's genius in his strategy. That if a man becomes fully devoted to him, he can lead another man to do the same, and another man to do the same, and another man to do the same. There's a man in Denver named Lou, and Lou runs this thing called Christ Ambassadors over into Israel, and it's pretty amazing. He's got a really neat ministry. He's an old guy. He's trained by the Navigators. He started his own organization, but he said this, and it stuck with me for a long time, and he said, Drew, most of the church in America today believes in Jesus' message. Okay, let me say that again. Most of the church in America today believes in Jesus' message. He said, however, the vast majority of the church in America today does not believe in Jesus' method of making disciples. And the reality is, if I can become one of those men who decides, I want to make disciples, I want to labor, I want to bring people out of the dominion of darkness through the power of Christ, I want to help them grow and become a mature man who knows how to feed on the word for himself and to pray to God and claim the promises and walk deeply and love others and to reach out to others, that is a life well lived. And in heaven, people say, how was your lifetime? Great. I had these 5 or 6 guys to show for it over the years, but I gave my life to them, and guess what happened? They gave their life to their friends, and then they gave their life to their, and to their, and the multiplication effect is just astonishing. Here we are 2,000 years later in Billings, Montana, or Fishtail, or wherever we are, talking about the Savior of the risen world because those 11 guys took it serious. Isn't that cool? I think, I want to finish on this idea that there's a cost to disciple making. I'm running a little bit over. There's a cost to being a laborer. You know, Jesus said in Luke 10, 2-3, I'm sending you out like lambs among the wolves. Thanks, Jesus. John 15, 18-25, right after that passage that we really looked at last night, he says, can I just tell you, the world's going to hate you because it hates me. You know, in our culture today, the young guys know what I say when we say haters gonna hate. And it's just gonna happen. The old guys are like, what? I don't even know what you're talking about. That's okay. They get it. Listen to what he says in verse 18 of chapter 15. If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That's why the world hates you. Can I just tell you, to be a laborer, the cost is very real. People will think you're nuts. They will no longer think you're cool. They might respect you, but they're going to start doing things like, oh, sorry to cuss around you, Nolan. My bad, buddy. I didn't know. They're going to feel that conviction around you. They're going to think you're living like a nutcase. It's just a reality. They're not going to figure out why you've chosen to live like this. It's just without reason they're going to do this. In verse 25 of that same passage, but this is to fill what is written in their law. They hated me without reason. It's not going to make sense. Jesus talked about in Luke 14 that the cost is real in following him. If we want to flip over there real quick, Luke 14. This is a fascinating passage. We're all familiar with it, but maybe not all of us understand it. Luke 14, 25 to 35. Jesus is talking to a large crowd, and there's obviously people who want to be running with Jesus. Lots of people going, hey, sign me up, coach, I'm in. And look at it, we're going to be in Luke 14, 25 to 35. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his mother and father, and his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Let's keep going a little further. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees him will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king goes out to war against another king. Will not first he sit down and consider whether he's able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming out against him with 20,000? If he's not able, he'll send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. And he goes on to say, salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, what's it good for? What an interesting passage Jesus would talk about in following him. Hey, anyone who wants to follow me, that's fine. You got to come to me, but you've got to hate your father and mother, your wife and your children, your brothers and sisters, yeah, even your own life, or he cannot be my disciple. Anyone who doesn't carry his own cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. What on earth is Jesus talking about? Doesn't he say honor your mother and father? What a strange letter that would be after you came to Christ, right? Dear mom and dad, I hate you. Love? No, not love. Drew. What is Jesus talking about here? A lot of us are married. We know that's a big place where we can highlight and elevate who we are to the world around us, that we love Christ. What Jesus is saying here, and in first century Jewish culture, they do a lot of comparison. And they compare one thing, they do these extremes of hyperbole. And he's saying, the love for me needs to be higher than all other relationships. He's not really saying go out and hate your mother and father. He's saying love God so supremely that it is on a whole other level than the most special relationships in your life. How many of you have ever gone to go and pick out a puppy? Anybody ever get to go to a litter of, maybe, you know, I remember as a boy going with my buddy Stephen Tarbox to go get a little cocker spaniel, and there was like five or six of these little bitty guys, and they each have a different color nail polish so you can keep them apart, and we're playing with these little puppies, and it's kind of like, you know, you go in there, and they're all cute, and they're up all around you, and they're playing, and they're licking you, and they're flopping around, and man, you just pick up one, and it's just got your heart, and you pick it up, and you, oh, what a cute little puppy. This is the one I want. This is him. And you step out of the pen and you just love this one more than the rest. They were all cute. It's not like you say, kill the rest. You know what I mean? But you just have this one that has elevated and captured your affection even more than all of that. Listen, I got a wife that many of you would dream about. You guys who aren't married, you want to marry my wife. Not my wife, but a woman just like it. That's sin to want my wife. But the reality is, as good as my marriage is, as much as I love my wife, as good, I always say the Lord and my wife treat me way better than I deserve. And as amazing as that relationship is, my relationship with God is more. As much as I love my kids and want to see them grow up and get old and be disciple makers themselves, if I had the choice to go and be with God or be with them, I'm ready to go. It's better to be with him. It's a good deal, but the cost is real. God is saying, boy, you've got to count the cost as you come into this. You ever think about Jesus' recruiting strategy? In Luke 9:23 says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. What a beautiful passage, but what a wild recruiting strategy. Deny yourself. How does that sound in our American culture today? Anybody? Facebook is surrounded by promoting yourself. I mean, you look at the different things in our culture, it's all about gratifying yourself, pleasure yourself. I mean, you name it, it's all about you. You're the star and the world's spinning around you. Jesus is saying, deny yourself, take up your cross every day, then you're fit to come follow me. What does he mean by take up our cross? Anybody? What's he mean when he says, take up your cross every day? Take up your cross. Yeah.
Be prepared to die.
Yeah. Great. Die to self. Yeah. I mean, the cross is a tool of execution. Strap yourself to the electric chair every morning and then you can follow me. That's how we would hear it. Whoa. It's not just a piece of jewelry. This was a torture device. Hey, once you've died to yourself and you're ready to do what I say and receive your commands from the king, then you can come follow me. How often does he say to do that? Every day. Why? Because we're men and we don't always want to do it. What a beautiful strategy. Fellas, I'd like you to follow me. All you need to do is deny yourself and die every day. Then you're fit. And that's the cost. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. I think of Hudson Taylor when he looked at the reaching the great masses in China. He said, I have found three things to be true with every great work of God. First, it's impossible. Then, it is difficult. Then, it is done. And I think in my own life, as I want to give more and more of my life over to God, that still rings true for me. It seems impossible. But as I start to say, God, would you use me? Would you work in me? It just becomes difficult. And then I feel him. I watch him change my life. But yes, there is great cost, and you will have to die to yourself. People will look at you differently. They'll think you're strange. But can I just tell you, there's also great reward. I think of Peter when he interacts with Jesus after Jesus starts teaching about really the sacraments and the communion in John 6. Jesus says, boy, you got to eat my flesh and drink my blood, or you have no part of me, that he is the bread of life that has come down from heaven. Do you guys remember this story? And it says, from that point on, a bunch of disciples turned away and no longer followed him. That was a great recruiting strategy, wasn't it? Bunch of dudes around, hey, you guys got to eat my flesh and drink my blood, or you have no part of me. He's talking about cannibalism, and they just walk out. See you, buddy, that's a little too much for me. And then he looks at the 12, and he says, do you want to leave too? What about you? Peter says one of the greatest things, I think, in all the New Testament. Verse 68. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and know that you are the Holy One of God. What, I don't know what you're talking about, Jesus. I don't get it, but I'm hooked. I've seen the way you heal people, how you love people, how you care for people, and I'm in. I don't get it all. You want me to eat your flesh? Then bring over some Tabasco and let's get started. But I don't know what you mean, but I'm in. I can't go back to fishing now. I've seen too much. You're moving in my life and you're moving all around me. I'm in, and I don't get it all. Can I tell you, if you decide to labor for Christ, he will ask you to do things that don't make sense. Isn't that right, Tim? Like leave your job, go into something that's totally different. How about it? I know each one of you could share a story about what God's asked you to do. Give up, change, start, quit, whatever it might be. Because he is worth it. And just like Peter, we might go, I don't understand what you're doing, but if you're telling me to do this, then I'm in. In Matthew 25:21, Jesus is giving a parable of the talents. And here we see over and over the servants that did a good job of investing the money they were given. We hear from the Father, good job, well done, good and faithful servant. Have we decided in our minds that we're going to live for an audience of one? I'm a recovering people pleaser. Anybody else? I mean, boy, I used to get worried about who was behind me in traffic and what were they thinking about my driving and was I going fast enough or too slow or whatever. It was bad. Now I'm a recovering, now I don't care what they think. Now I just drive how I want, you know what I mean? But the reality here of just, I was a people pleaser for so long that I was trying to win the approval of all these other people, and the verse Galatians 1:10 was huge for me. And Paul says, am I now trying to win the approval of men or of God? Or am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. Isn't that beautiful? Am I now trying to win the approval of men or of God? Am I trying to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I wouldn't be a servant of Christ. Galatians 1:10. And have I started to live for that audience of one? Would I want a whole stadium filled of people cheer me on for all the wrong things? Or can I be satisfied with just hearing God applaud me for the right things? You know, one day, this life will move on. One day, our great hope is that we will be with God. Let's flip over to a picture of that in Revelation 21. Go back to your concordance and then forward just a few pages. One chapter away from the end of the Bible here. Revelation 21 gives us a beautiful picture. The Apostle John is now an old man, exiled onto an island, most likely has his eyes burned out. He was probably the only disciple that died a natural death, even though he was exiled and excommunicated. Revelation 21, 1 through 5, John wrote down a lot of things that even he didn't understand. But this one's pretty clear. And I love the picture that we get here. And this is the great reward for those who labor for the King. It says in verse 1, 21, 1 through 5, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. Now, how many of you guys are married men? Anybody? Remember when those doors opened up and your wife was standing there? She looked good. Real good. My wife, I was like, whoa, Nelly. Should have done this a lot sooner. Those doors opened up. We had 300-400 people at our wedding, and I'm just like, you got to be kidding me. This girl's going to give herself to me. Miracles do happen. And here comes the new Jerusalem out of heaven from God, coming to us like a bride beautifully prepared for her husband. I think we're going to be going, what? Are you, what? This is what our great expectation is. In verse 3, listen to how good it'll be to be in that place. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Amen. Verse 5 is one of my favorite passages in Revelation. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, hey, John, write this down. These words are trustworthy and true. I can only imagine being John in that situation. Whoa! What he's seeing, are you kidding me? Wow! And then God's saying, man, there'll be no more crying, mourning, or pain. The old order of things is, I'm making everything new. And John's probably going, whoa! John, hey, you got to take this back to him. Write this stuff down, man. This is true. This is going to happen. Oh, okay. And he's trying to figure it out, and then he comes back. Game on. I love it that the Lord has to command him. Hey, stop being so distracted. Write this down. People need to know this is a reality, that this is coming. This is their great reward. When Dr. J wakes up and says, this is more amazing than you can ever imagine. I think Jay's seeing some of the same things. And I want us to look at each other when we get there and say, Corey, how was your life? Adam, how was your life? Rich, how did it go? Wes, how was it? Othniel, how'd you do? And that we could say, man, I got truckloads of sin that Jesus forgave. But I swung for the fence. I labored in the harvest field. I reached other men for him that they might do the same. And now the end has come, and we get to enter into our master's happiness and hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. Let's pray. Father, thanks for this time together. We are grateful, Lord. I think of even Dawes saying, it became clear that when one man became a true disciple, then another could become one, and then another, and then hundreds, and then thousands. But it starts with one. Lord, would you help us understand that we are qualified only by you? Lord, that we could have a lifestyle of laboring because you've called us into your family. and Lord, that you would be made much of. Jesus, I want to pray for these men here in Billings and around Montana, that you would bless them, watch over them, protect them. But Lord, would you fan the flame of your very spirit inside of them? Lord, whether young or old, that they would seize the opportunities that you've put before them to work as laborers in your harvest field. Lord, I know we all want to drive the combine. I know we all want to see lots of people come to you, but Lord, would you help us be satisfied with going after a reliable man who wants to teach others also? Lord, we would profess that even your ministry on the outside might not have had all the fanfare, but it's been so effective. Lord, we know that you're going to continue to reach the world for you, and we thank you that you would ask us to partner with you. Would we see that as a great privilege and the best job opportunity we're ever going to have? We know you can do this, Lord. We thank you that you're doing it, and we pray you'd use us in mighty ways. Would you draw us to yourself, that we would be with you? Lord, would you motivate us in our hearts that we would labor for you?